We have our front end in TypeScript. We have our back end in TypeScript. I want our GraphQL resolver code to also be written in TypeScript. Now, the interesting thing is that AppSync doesn't actually accept TypeScript. So what we're going to be doing in this video is setting up our application so that we can write TypeScript, have it transpiled to JavaScript, and still have all of our create, read, update, delete, and list functionality. This is where we left off last time. I'm going to bump this up one time for us here. So that way we have our API, it's given a name, it knows where our schema is thanks to this definition. We are protecting it with an API key, as you can see here. And then we are logging out any details and as well as enabling X-ray. Pretty cool. We're passing in our DynamoDB table. That's going to be our data source, but we need to say, hey, this is how you get the data, or this is how you insert the data, etc. Now we want our application to be written in TypeScript, specifically our resolver code. So what I'm going to do first and foremost is install a couple dependencies. The first one is going to be the AppSync dependencies that we need. And these are all going to be dev dependencies. We don't need them in prod or anything like that. But I am going to bring in the AWS AppSync utils, as well as ESBuild and glob. And you'll see why I need those two, specifically glob, in just a moment here. Now, I think the best way to actually show what's going on here is to just show you, and instead of just trying to talk through everything. So what I'm going to do here is over in my GraphQL folder, I'm going to create a brand new directory. And this is going to be living inside of a TS underscore functions directory. And I'm going to call this create pet dot TS, very specifically create pet dot TS for us, just like that. Inside of here, I can get rid of that sidebar. Inside of here, I'm going to paste in what we're actually going to be doing here. So we have this set up. We're importing everything from DynamoDB from this util package. You can see we just installed this, right? But we get two things off of it. We get DynamoDB utils, as you can see on this first line. And then we also get the context and the sort of global util for AppSync. Now, we're going to be seeing how the heck we got this line 3. Like, where is this coming from? And what is it doing for us in just a moment here? Let's walk through the rest of this. How AppSync works is that it does two things. It does the request and it does the response. The request is essentially, hey, you're expecting me to talk to some data source that I'm hooked up to. What am I passing to it? And then the response is, this is what I got back. In our case, we're going to DynamoDB, and the response is going to be automatically parsed from DynamoDB into something that AppSync can understand. Now we are putting, this is a create pet resolver, right? We're going to put on here an ID, and we're going to have the ID automatically generated for us, just like that. And then for the item, we also have any input that we want to pass in. So we know that a pet expects, if we look at our schema, our pet is expecting an ID, a name, and a type. So we know that we can pass in the name and the type just like that. So we have the dog Remy and then the type of dog, and it has a specific ID. Now this is just to showcase some of the functionality, but as you might recall, we want to tweak this because when we look at our pets table, the actual partition key is going to be underscore type name and the sort key is going to be an ID. But we still want the ID automatically generated for us. So what we can do here, because we're living in JavaScript land, is I can come up here and I can say, hey, the ID is going to be automatically generated just like that. But then the actual key of this item is going to be underscore type name. And then we have the pet right here. Now I did make a quick little mistake. The type name is both the ID as well as the sort key. So I need to get these two nested in there if I can manage to do, there we go. Whoops. So I can say, hey, this ID is going to be coming from an automatically generated ID. So that's going to be util dot, and then we have this auto ID living right here. Pretty cool. So I don't have to install a third-party package to get that set up. We have both of these fields living right there. And then, of course, the name and the type of the pet can be coming off of this context.args, the context being similar to a Lambda event, right? You have the event.body, in this case, context.args, and then whatever input the user provided. Now, one of the things that you might be wondering is, like, how does it know that it's context.args, which is typical AppSync stuff, but .input? If I use IntelliSense here, context.args, that .input is going to automatically be provided for me. Now, it's not right now because it's, yo, I don't know what these mutation variables are even going to be. Can you help me out? Now, how we get that functionality is by creating something that is known as a GraphQL config. Pretty popular in the GraphQL community, but it's simply a file that defines how the heck you want your GraphQL to be configured. Now, this is really handy because Amplify will take advantage of this and automatically create all these typings for us. So here's what I'm gonna paste in here. And again, this repo will be available within the description. So definitely check that out. But Amplify is going to look at this and say, yo, we have your schema living right next to us. We have our schema.graphql living right here. I'm going to be looking for anything inside of a TypeScript, any TypeScript files, pretty much. And we're going to take those and we're going to create a source directory with an API.ts that contains all of our types. Now, the rest of this is pretty much just boilerplate code that you can stick in. Like your region could be any region, for example. Your API ID can be null. And the JavaScript in the front end, this is used for a CLI, but this is a headless mode. So that's why you see these here. One thing to note that might be important down the road for you is that this max depth is basically making sure that whatever gets generated isn't going to be infinitely generated, right? You don't have a dog of type pet and that pet has an age. And you can get pretty deep in terms of GraphQL. This just prevents that. So I'm going to hit save here. Now I'm going to be using the Amplify CLI, but I have to be inside of that directory. So I'm going to say CD. And then I'm going to drag over this GraphQL directory, just like that. And if I ls, you can see that I have that schema.graphql. If I do ls-a, I also have this GraphQL config.yaml, exactly what I need. And I'm going to say npx aws amplify, I believe it's at aws amplify /CLI. And I'm going to say codegen. So this is a globally available package. And once I hit enter, you can see it created this source directory for me just like that. I have API with all of my types. And if I get rid of this stuff on the side, you can see my API.ts file created everything I need for my pet, including context.args.input. Here it is under that create pet mutation variables. Pretty cool. And I don't have to worry about writing any of that stuff. Get rid of all of the red squigglies for me. And in case I want to run AppSync code on the backend, I also have my mutations and queries living right here. I think that's pretty powerful, honestly. Now, before we can actually wire this up, we still have one problem. And that problem is we've written TypeScript code, but AppSync doesn't understand TypeScript. It understands JavaScript. So recall that we installed ESBuild and glob. And note that we have this ts_functions directory. What I can do is come over here into my backend, the root of my backend directory, create a new file. And I'm going to call this build.mjs. Note that node is in a weird flux right now. So I use the MJS syntax or file extension. So that way we can have import and export. But let me go ahead and bring this over here to show you what we're doing. Nothing too crazy. We have these two packages, right? They're going to say, hey, look at everything inside of this TS functions directory that ends in .ts. For the sake of just troubleshooting, I log out the files. But it really is this 10 lines of code that does all the work for us. We're basically taking that TypeScript and we're building it to regular JavaScript. Now, where we're going to be sticking this thing is going to be inside of a folder right next to it, js_functions, right? Now, the format ESM, target ES_next, so that way we're working with the latest versions of JavaScript, even though we are in a node context. But all this is here. We also include source maps so that way we have easy debugging. But yeah, that's what we have right here. So now if I go ahead and say, for example, backup added this deeply nested structure, maybe go one more. There we go. So if I'm here and I have all this pulled up, if I say npm run build.mjs, we'll see what we get. Oh, of course that wouldn't work. I need to say node build.mjs, just like that. It logged out the one file. And if I look inside of my lib directory and I go to API, GraphQL, you can see I have my TS functions, which is my pet.ts. Let me make some room here. This is what we had originally, maybe bump that down one. And then if I go over to my JS functions, now I have what AppSync can expect. I have everything set up with source mappings, TypeScript removed, and it's put into basically JavaScript format. Super cool, super handy, because all I have to do to get this wired up from AppSync to DynamoDB is just say, yo, I want to add a resolver. And since I already have DynamoDB set up as my data source, if I come over to AppSync right here and I want to add that resolver, it's just like this. So I want to create my resolver using my pet as a data source. So how does my resolver know to talk to that specific DynamoDB table? It's because I have it defined here on line 35. I'm going to create a resolver. I'm going to give it an ID called create resolver. And then the type name is going to be for the mutation, create pet, and this is following my schema. So if I look at my schema, I have mutation, create pet, these two line up. The runtime, I'm going to be using JavaScript instead of VTL. And then the code that I'm going to be using for this isn't going to be inline. It's going to be from a asset, which is basically a file. And it's called js_createpet.js. Okay, so I went ahead and I just basically copy and pasted this same format to get all of the other operations that we need. So scrolling down here, we have querying for a list of pets. You can see this query pets resolver here. And they're all going to the respective JavaScript files. Now, I also have get pet resolver. I kind of see the flow here, right? Update and deleting right here at the bottom. All looking good, but let's actually take a peek at what those other operations look like when we use these utils. So we know we have create. Now, when I go to delete a pet, it's actually pretty much the same thing. Note that I have delete pet mutation variables listed right here. And by providing that, if I didn't have this right here, let's just get rid of that. All good, except when I go to context.args, I don't get any IntelliSense. So if I back this up a little bit and I have delete pet mutation variables and I do context.args dot, I get my pet ID. You may be wondering, like, Michael, where did that pet ID come from? Well, recall that over in our schema, sort of the beauty of the type safety, when we have delete pet right here, we are saying that it needs a pet ID. Other times it needs an input, right? But when you get a pet or when you delete a pet, it needs that pet ID to be able to return back to you a pet. So cool, we have that. This is ddb.remove right here coming from this util package. And then we are still going to return a pet and it has to be in the format of what we expect. Looking at the get pet operations, it's gonna be again the same thing. You know where this pet ID is coming from off of this get pet query variables. And then the rest is pretty much copy, paste, all throughout the board. These get interesting when we go to list pets. Technically, if we had a large data set, we could be using a query. You could absolutely do, right? ddb.query is living right here. But we have a smaller data set, so we're just going to scan the table. We're not working with a huge amount of pets. Anything over, I don't know, 1,000. And it would be, you know, nested fields. Then we can look at queries. Anything under that, a scan is perfectly fine. But one of the interesting things is that we have context.result. And then we have .items here because it's going to give us an object back. And that object is going to say things, you know, the total count and max tokens or the optional token since we're in GraphQL. But in our case, we want the items, which is going to be an array of pets. And we're casting it as that array of pets. Lastly, we have this update pet operation. This is going to take in that same format, you know, the API living right here. And of course, we can always inspect that if you want to take a closer look, but it has input of type update pet input. And then we have a type name of pet. Everything is following that because when we designed our table, keep in mind that we said, yeah, the key is actually made up of two parts. We have the underscore type name, which is a string. And then we have the sort key, which is the actual ID. A couple of interesting things on this one is that even though we have this key right here, we are still updating something. So we're saying, hey, update whatever you need to coming from the arguments, if those exist. Technically, I could do something, you know, since I'm in JavaScript land, you know, context.args.input, perfectly valid. However, I don't want to do that. I'm going to go ahead and say, yeah, this is going to be my actual args just like so. Cool. We have that set up. I think I should probably just make sure everything is saved. Do a quick save all. There we go. And then as I mentioned, going through here, we have all of our resolvers already hooked up. Now, I mentioned this in the last video, but one of the things that I did add was add this deploy script. So I'm just going to run npm run deploy. Cool little trick, though, is that I don't want to have to remember to do node build.mjs. So what I'm doing here is having a pre-deploy script. So that way it automatically finds pre and then deploy. It's going to look for deploy. So anytime I run deploy, this is going to get triggered. So my JavaScript functions will be created automatically for me. Nothing too crazy. I'm going to go ahead and build this out. So you can see npm run deploy. And then we have that node script being automatically, you know, set up for us. This is going to go do its thing. Assuming that deploy is working out great. There we go. I am going to move over to the AppSync console. Okay. So we're in the AppSync console. I'm going to bump this up for us one time for the one time. And then over on this right-hand side, we can click on queries, right? Now let's make ourselves cozy here and get some room. And You can see that I was already testing this out before. No big deal here. So I'm going to, can I bring this up at all? I can't. So I'm going to go ahead and run our query. So I'm going to say my query, which is this list pets operation. Now we don't have any items inside of our database currently. No big deal. I'm going to come over here and say, I want to have a mutation, and that mutation is going to be the ability to create a pet. Now I'm going to get rid of this delete operation. We're not using that one. And over on this sidebar here, I can say when it comes to creating a pet, I'm not going to give you an ID. I could if I wanted to, right? But I'm going to have AppSync create the ID automatically for me. So for the name, I'm going to, my main man here, this is Remy, Chocolate Lab, and he is a dog. So when I click on my mutation, I get back an ID. And that's because I specifically asked for an ID to come back. And then I get this unique ID. I'm just going to copy that. And when I go to list out the items inside of my database, I go to my query, and sure enough, I get this ID and I get Remy Dog here. Note what I don't get. I'm not leaking implementation details of where the data is stored. I don't have the underscore type name. Pretty cool. Now, if I wanted to, let's just hop back to the code here. Just something to show you real quick. If I wanted to, it's common to have something like a created at and an updated at field, right? Something like this. Created at, and then this is typically an AWS date time. I think that's what it is. If we look at some of the scalers, and if I wanted that automatically created for me, so when I create a pet, I can say for the item context.args.input, fine, but I do want to essentially expand this out, right? So I'm going to go like that, do one of these, and then I can say, this isn't going to work because of the typings involved, but I can say I want the created at time to be not this automatically formatted stuff, but I can say util dot, and then we have a time, there we go, dot. And then we have all of these options available to us depending on how I wanted to display that inside of my database. Super, super cool. I think in this case, what I would be looking for is a maybe now ISO, you would call that. Great. So we have that just to let you know some of the options. Definitely check out the documentation to see what is available to you. But notice that we have exactly what we want. AppSync, talking to DynamoDB, all in TypeScript without the use of a single Lambda function. Now, one last thing I am going to do is that if I go over to my settings and then come down here to monitoring, I need to look for it. I'm not exactly sure where it's living these days. Looks like we have X-ray living right there. And then if I go to tracing, I can view these logs in X-ray. And this is a really cool way to see, you know, how fast these things are taking. You can see all of these calls. Here's 50, here's the P99. And then when it comes to a specific call, let's say we're going to run a query, we have our pets API. You can sort of trace every invocation that is happening here, which I think is super great. We have essentially the ones that we just hit up a little bit. If I click on this one, this is our pets API talking to DynamoDB. How long did it take? Looks like the entire response took, if I back it up a little bit, 0.57 seconds. That's a huge advantage over using this over something like Lambda. But I will go ahead and leave that for you to sort of play around with on your own. All right, so there we have it, folks. In this series, super short compared to the last API gateway series, we went ahead and set up our project in addition to creating the AppSync talking to DynamoDB stack. Now, in the next series, we are going to be working on the front end because there have been some improvements on the Amplify side that are super exciting, regardless of whether you're having a typical client-side application or you are using some of these really cool React server components and you have that. Amplify has your back. We're going to be connecting it to our CDK code. I'll check you all then. It's going to be a good time, but until then, peace.